My name is Arthur Bergman. I serve as the lead pastor of St. Paul's Lutheran Church and School. And it's so good that we can be online together this day. Today we're going to enjoy a St. Paul's tradition. It's Holden evening prayer, which we enjoy at 6:30 during our Lenten series. So enjoy yourself, sing along, and now let us gather for worship.
Jesus Christ, you are the light of the world.
The light no darkness can overcome.
Stay with us now, for it is evening,
and the day is almost over.
Sure.
May our prayers come before you, O God, as incense, and may your presence surround and fill us, so that in union with all creation, we might sing your praise and your love in our lives. Amen. A reading from St. Luke, the 19th chapter. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man there was named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and he climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and he said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry down, for I must stay at your house this day." So he hurried down and he was happy to welcome him. And all who saw it began to grumble and said, "He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor, and if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Then Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost." Word of God, word of life. So I bet you've heard this joke before. How many Lutherans does it take to change a light bulb? The response? What do you mean, change? I think all of us struggle with the reality of change in our life and just how fast and furious it comes at us. I'm sure you have heard this phrase, "The more things change, the more they stay the same." This was uttered by a man whose name was Jean-Baptiste Carr. He was a French writer in the 1800s, and he had a satirical and sharp wit. But it is a cynical approach he has to change. He says it's going to happen, but nothing good will occur from it. He's also suggesting that perhaps even terrible things could fall. I understand that cynical approach, especially in this day and age of coronavirus. But is this the right perspective we should have about change right now? I'm thinking of my first congregation. It was born on the ashes of an old one, Living Christ Lutheran Church in Loves Park, Illinois. This is a congregation that had gotten to the point where they couldn't afford a full-time pastor, they had only 50 people in worship, and they had only 3 children in programming. And those 3 children were all siblings. Now, at that time, the church came to them and said, "Well, we're willing to try something new with you, but it's going to involve drastic change." They said, "You're going to have to sell your building. You're going to have to buy new property out in Boone County where all the growth is taking place. You'll have to call a mission developer. We'll have to shut down your constitution. You'll have to move into a storefront church. And there'll be no worship over the summer as your new mission developer," that's me, "knocks on doors." And the congregation was thrilled and excited about this change. They knew full well that it may not work, but they embraced it, and they were positive, because it was an act of faith. But I also remember this one older couple. I called on them, and they were very polite, and they were very kind, but they said to me, "Pastor, we're not going to the storefront church. This is a church that has failed, and it's going to fail again. We're going to be joining Grace Lutheran Church in Loves Park." They were cynical. And as I thought to myself over the years, how much fun had they missed because they hadn't joined the rest of us in that storefront church? As we think about perspective and change, we can begin to see the pattern emerge. There's 2 paths. One is to be cynical, and the other is to be faithful. Our story today with Zacchaeus is another example of a story about change. Zacchaeus was a chief tax collector. Let me remind you about the Roman taxation system. What occurred is the Romans would set up a territory and appoint a tax collector for that region. And then what would occur is that person would be given a dollar amount that was expected to be picked up. And of course, they were given Roman muscle to make sure that all the funds could be gathered. Now, anything they gathered above and beyond, the tax collector got to put in their own pocket. Zacchaeus, being a chief tax collector, in fact, he got to skim over all of the tax collector's proceeds. It was lucrative. Zacchaeus would have been a wealthy man. And it was immoral. He was stealing from his fellow countrymen and women. Well, Jesus was in town, and he decided that he wanted to see Jesus. He was short in stature, and he knew that if he pushed through the crowds, the people wouldn't care too much for him, it might be dangerous. So he scampered up a sycamore tree. And of course, Jesus would spot him and he would come over. And of course, I think maybe many of us remember the old Sunday school song. He would say, "Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm coming to your house today. For I'm coming to your house today." Well, what happens when Jesus comes to someone's house? Mary and Martha know this. Everything changes, and it changes for the better. Now, there were those in the crowd who grumbled, who didn't believe that Zacchaeus had any capacity to change. They were the ones who were cynical. But Zacchaeus had already been transformed. He made that pledge to go back and repay everyone that he had defrauded. Change had come to Zacchaeus's life. Today, as we think about our own membership, I'm drawn to Liz and John Wirtz. Liz Wirtz is my administrative assistant here at St. Paul's, and if anyone has gone through change this past year, it was Liz Wirtz. You might know that last year she was diagnosed with brain cancer, the same brain cancer that Senator John McCain of Arizona was diagnosed with. Now, if anybody had the right to be cynical, it most certainly was Liz. But she never was. Not once. Yes, there were some fearful moments, but she was always grounded in faith. She was a person that I was with the day after her surgery. I was there on the day where her bus went down with her friends and family for her final treatment in Iowa City. And I've been with her along the journey. And I can tell you that I have had a front row seat to watching her faith and her positive energy as she managed this disease. She is an example for us all. Well, as you know, this is the time in my sermon where I often say, pull out your reflection cards. We can't do that right now, but what I can do is direct you with what I want you to reflect upon. A new normal has settled down upon us, and this video is proof of that, right? I want everyone to pause and to think about the changes that are coming our way. And we have two choices. We can either be cynical, which is the location of fear and denial, which is what I spoke about in last Sunday's sermon. And that denial is where we say it's no big deal and we take no precautions to protect ourselves and others. Or the fear-based behavior that we've seen even in our own community with people overpurchasing, preventing neighbor from being able to prepare as well. The other way is for us to be people who are faithful. And this is the location of wisdom and love, as described in last Sunday's sermon as well. When we talk about love and wisdom, this is why St. Paul's has shut down. We want to keep each and every one of you protected. See, we love you, and it's that time for us to make sure that we manage this change in the most faithful way possible. Well, all of us need perspective, and faith in God is what gives us perspective and change. In Jesus' name, amen.
Went from God to a town called Nazareth to a woman whose name was Mary. The angel said to her, "Rejoice, O highly favored, for God is with you. You shall bear a child. Name shall be Jesus, the chosen one of God Most High." And Mary said, "I am the servant of my God. I live to do your will. My soul proclaims your greatness, O God, and my spirit rejoices in you. You have looked with love. peace between nations, for peace between peoples.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
For us who are gathered to worship and praise you.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
For all of your servants who live out your gospel. Might guide them.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
For all those who labor in service to others.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
Grant weather that nourishes all of creation.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
Watch on our loved ones and keep us from danger.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
For all the beloved who rest in your mercy.
God of mercy, hold us in love.
Help us, comfort us, all of our days.
Hold us, gracious God.
Great and merciful God, source and ground of all goodness and life, give to your people the peace that passes all understanding and the will to live your gospel of mercy and justice through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let us bless our God.
Praise and thanks to you.
May God, Creator, bless us and keep us. May Christ be ever light for our lives. May the Spirit of love be our guide and path for all of our days.
I'm so glad that we could join together online this very day. Tomorrow, join with Dr. Chris Meyer at 4:30 as we have school worship and she'll share a message. I want to remind all of you that God loves you and so do I.